Most leaders don't communicate the right way. They mean well, but they don't get the results they need. When you think about how we're supposed to communicate during change and what's espoused, leaders are encouraged to be collaborative, you know, get input, give feedback on the input. They also want to be authentic, so be upfront, be transparent, be credible, and of course, be active, be visible. Make sure you're communicating in multiple ways. And all of that is geared to fostering a vibrant two-way information flow, up, down, sideways, whatever. The reality is, it doesn't usually happen that way. There was an interesting study that was described recently in the Harvard Business Review entitled, "Can Your Employees Really Speak Freely?" And based on all their research, the answer was emphatically no. Yes, sir?
Only the smart one.
Okay, very good. And in that article, the authors cited two primary reasons. Now, the number two reason was fear, and I threw in my humor slide on this one, meaning it's not safe to speak up, I don't want to appear offside, I certainly don't want to contradict the boss. And the number one reason was it's futile. What's the point? They don't listen anyway. Their minds are made up. In fact, in a book I wrote a few years ago, the only thing worse than not asking for an employee's input is to get that input and do nothing with it. So that's the challenge. Now, the tool I'm going to show you right now really alleviates both of those issues. And as I mentioned, I call it the four-box model. Here's how the change tool works. In any change, you're moving from what I call status quo on the left, that's how things currently function, towards the change on the right. Box number one represents the downside or disadvantages of how things work now, of status quo. Box number four represents the advantages of how things work now, status quo. Box number two represents the advantages of the change, and box number three represents the downsides to the change. Now think about it for a moment. If someone's mandated with communicating an organizational change, whether I'm senior executive, middle management, whatever, and my goal ultimately is to get others to embrace this change, which box or boxes do you think communicators will instinctively speak to first? And you're absolutely right. A number of people are zeroing in on box number two. In fact, in over 90% of the cases that I examined, the speaker will immediately and sometimes only speak to box two. And the reason for that is it feels perfectly natural, it represents the advantages and benefits. In addition to box two, if the communicator was also inclined to speak to one other box, they speak to box one. Because box one answers the critical question, so why are we doing this anyway? You know, prove to me this is necessary. So citing my Molson example, at that time we were merging with Carling, the president called us into the conference room and he said, "I want to talk to you about an exciting new opportunity for Molson." He said, "Effective next July will be the new Molson, bigger, better. We're going to, you know, by merging with Carling, we're going to have increased market share, more products, better geographical representation, improved efficiencies." He went on this way, when you think about it, which box is he speaking to? Of course, it's box two. And I often call that cheerleading or hype. So he went on and on and two, and finally, after several minutes, our senior union steward put up his hand and said, "Excuse me, but doesn't merger mean downsize?" And the president said, "Ah, well, that's a very good question. So let me explain to you why we must make this change." And he had the facts to prove it, actually. He said, "The reality is, with the move to freer trade, no more barriers that used to protect us," he said, "the reality is, if we don't become bigger and quickly, within 3 or 4 years, we would actually have to shut down a couple of our plants and let go several hundred of our employees, and we don't want to do that." That actually was true. Which box did he speak to? Of course, that was box one. So the point of that mini story was communicators always speak to box two. They may also include box one, but boxes one and two are the entire focus of the presentation. Now, We all know that most employees and other stakeholders initially experience some resistance to change. I don't like it, I don't agree with it, maybe I don't even trust the change. So if I'm in resistance and I'm in your audience, which I would be, which boxes am I thinking about and frankly completely fixated on up there? And again, I'm sure you're zeroing in, they're focused on box three and box four. Box three represents what I worry about with the change, the perceived downsides. In the Molson example, that meant reapplying in some cases for our own position. In some cases, relocating to a new facility or reporting to a new boss. Box four is everything I value about current state. Hey, listen, I like working for this person. I get good performance reviews, and I've invested a lot of energy in this project. Don't mess with that. So I call this the natural disconnect. Sorry. The natural persuasion pattern of anyone communicating change is to talk up boxes one and two, especially box two. The natural thought pattern of the very people you're trying to engage, they're completely fixated on three and four. This is literally two ships in the night that will never meet. It's literally like we're having a business meeting and we're not even on the same page. And I can't tell you how many meetings I'm invited to where the CEO is hyping box two and the audience is completely in three and four. So let me show you a better way. It's the same tool. And a few years later, after I left Molson, I was part of a small business, 20, 25 employees, and we had to upgrade our technology. Now, just so you know, our employees loved the technology. They were good at it. They were even bonused on their work with it. But our customers didn't. They said it was cumbersome. Some had even said if we didn't fix things, they would take their business somewhere else. But this time, the communicator did it the right way. Came into the room, and he said, I want to talk to you about us moving from our current system to this new system, and I'm sure many of you are wondering, why would we ever do that? Because I know how much you value our current system. So as you can see, he's starting in box one. You must convey the burning platform for change. So he went on. As you know, we were getting some informal negative feedback. We'd hired a third party. She's with us today. And as you can see from the results of her survey, over 20% of our key customers are saying either fix the technology or we may leave you. And if even only half those people did that, we'd be in big trouble. So if you do a good job in box one, that doesn't mean they love the change you're proposing. It simply gives them, they simply realize why they might want to listen. He went there. Now, then he went up to box two, but in this model, you want to spend initially your least amount of time in box two. You can go back to it later, but initially, you want to downplay box two because it's the least compelling box to most folks in the room. Not us who are driving the change. The people were asking to accept the change. So he said, so very briefly, as I said, we'd like to move to this new system. That will allow us to maintain and grow our customer base, and we'd like to believe it's a valuable skill for you, our employees, to have. But what I really want to talk about today is what we perceive might be some of your concerns with this change, and wherever possible, how we can help you with these issues. I'm not suggesting we know them all, but we've tried to take the time to think through where we can support them. He said, one of your concerns, and as you can see, he's now moved to box three, one of your concerns might be your performance record in terms of achieving your KPIs. Because if there's going to be a learning curve as we adjust to this new system, and if you're measured on the accuracy and quality of your work, could this come back to hurt you from a compensation point of view? He said, that's a valid concern. One idea we have is to either alter or revise that metric in the performance management system. We'll work with you on what that might be. He said, some of you are probably worried about workload, meaning if it's going to take longer, does this mean, again, you'll be here till 10 o'clock every night just handling the volume and that you won't have a personal life or a home life? He said, we absolutely want you to have proper work-life balance. And one thought we had, and we're open to other ideas, is we could hire a couple of temps, at least in the short term, to help with the overload. He said, I'm sure my IT folks are thinking now's not the time to schedule another IT project and this will be disruptive. He said, I don't have the answer for that, but that's a valid concern. And what I'd like to suggest is maybe some of our IT folks can let us know how we can best schedule this in a way that's not disruptive. And then he said, finally, I want to talk about what's not changing. Those things you value that will stay exactly the same even after this change. You're still going to have the same roles. Those of you that have customer responsibilities, that won't change. We'll even leave the old software as a backup in the short term. And then he said, any questions? Now, unlike most change presentations I go to, he got lots of questions, and you want that. So that sort of brings me to the end of my little mini demo. Why is this model effective? Let me just quickly summarize. Box one is critical. People have to understand why are we doing this. And I can't tell you how many times I've gone to middle managers and they say to me, I have no clue. And I'm not looking forward to having to sell this to my people. Box three is critical because box three, you're taking their very issues and putting them on the table before they even ask it. So there's an interest-based approach. You're showing that you value their concerns and you want to work with them. And box four is also important because it has a calming effect. It reassures them that we're only changing what we need to change and we're going to keep what needs to be kept. So that's the end of my quick presentation on the four-box model. But what I can suggest is you can easily apply this tool and I think you'll get significantly better change results. Thank you very much.